Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Tushar Mehta. I'm an orthopedic surgeon and DAMS faculty for orthopedics. I've been giving you videos about some important topics of orthopedics in the past as well. In continuation of that series, today I wish to present in front of you a common joint, that is elbow, in which we will be talking about the two important aspects of elbow. One is the anatomy, its basics, its clinical aspect, and I will try to connect that dot of anatomy along with the important orthopedic injury, that is elbow dislocation. So let's begin. First thing first, if you take a look at the anatomy of elbow, I'm sure you can certainly point out a couple of things, like this is one bone, that is humerus, this is radius, this is ulna, in which obviously this is the lateral side, this is the medial side, and this is the capitulum, this is the trochlea, this is the radial head, and this trochlea has to be articulated with this bone called as ulna. Now what actually happens is, let's take a look at the other image, which is the posteroanterior image. You can very clearly see that this is the olecranon process, and there is one more process called as coronoid process, which I can show you in this anteroposterior view. This olecranon and coronoid process, they go into the olecranon fossa. So this is the olecranon fossa in the distal part of the humerus onto the posterior aspect, into which olecranon process goes and gets fitted into it. So this is about the basic anatomy. This is the coronoid fossa. This is for the coronoid process. So I was just, you know, wanting you to get yourself tuned to the basic anatomy. Now, you must have noticed one thing, that in this anatomy, you have actually got three joints. Let me show these three joints to you. This is the first joint that you see. This is the second joint that you see. And maybe I can show you the third joint, maybe here. There's a little clustering up here. So there are three joints. So let's talk about them one by one. You know, this first joint that you see here is basically the radiocapitellar joint, okay. The second one that you see here is basically the ulnotrochlear joint. And the third one that you see here is what is called as the superior radio ulnar joint. Aap samajhe meri baat, teen joint ho gaye. Ek taraf, there is a radiocapitellar joint. On the other hand, you have a ulnotrochlear joint. On the third side, you have a superior radio ulnar joint. Why I have shown you these three joints, don't worry, I'll make it clear in front of you, because elbow is a compound joint. This is a very, very important thing about anatomy of elbow, that it is a compound synovial joint. We call it a compound synovial joint. Now, in this compound synovial joint, as I have already told you, that there are three types of joints. Why do we have three types of joints? To allow different movements. The first joint is radiocapitellar joint. It is of pivot variety, also called as trochoid joint. What is the significance of this radiocapitellar joint? You know, this allows pronation and supination. Are you understanding my point? So this radiocapitellar joint, that basically allows you pronation and supination. And students, I'm assuming that you are aware of what's pronation and supination, right? Now, the second joint that we have here is what is called as the ulnotrochlear joint. Let me just enforce one more fact into your head, that is, ulnotrochlear joint is comparatively more stable and it is more contributing towards the stability of the elbow as a whole. This is a hinge or a gingivalimus kind of a joint. So this radiocapitellar is basically a pivot type, trochoid type. Hinge is a ulnotrochlear is a hinge type, and that's why we call elbow as a compound joint or a complex joint, because it is composed of two different joints, pivot type and hinge type. The third one that you have here is superior radio ulnar joint. I hope you remember, we have spoken about this superior radio ulnar again. So just like radiocapitellar, this is again of pivot or trochoid type, and since it is of pivot and trochoid type, therefore it also allows you pronation and supination, while ulnotrochlear allows you flexion and extension. So now we got the gist of it. Compound synovial joint, further three joints, ulnotrochlear, radiocapitular, superior radioulnar. Radiocapitular, superior radioulnar, they are pivot type, trochoid type. They allow supination pronation. Ulnar trochlear is a hinge joint which allows flexion and extension. So far, so good. Now, let's take a look at the lateral view. Wow, beautiful. Let's take a look at the lateral view. Abhi dekhte hain isko. Identify the bones. I've always told you in all my lectures previously as well, try to talk to an image. An image will talk to you in your exam. So, abhi sirf photo dekho aur baat ko samjho. Radius, of course. Ulna, of course. Humerus, of course. Lateral view of the elbow, of course. Olecranon process, of course. Coronoid process, of course. I can see clearly. This side is capitulum along with trochlea, of course. So, you have this capitulum, yes. You have this trochlea, yes. Alright, now you can very clearly see, you can very clearly see this is the head of radius. Okay, so you can see the radiocapitular joint, you can see the ulnotrochlear joint, okay, and you can see the superior radioulnar joint. Alright, so certain things are clear here. Now, this again I would like to emphasize upon is radial notch. So, this is that radial notch into which radial head, radial notch is a notch in ulna. This is a very interesting point. Huh? Radial notch, nam radial, but hai ulna mein, because the head of radius goes and gets fit into that radial notch making superior radial ulnar joint. I think we have now got the alignment and orientation of anatomy. The bony anatomy. Now let's talk about the soft tissue anatomy. Elbow stabilizers. Like every joint, elbow has got two types of stabilizer. One is called static, another one is called as dynamic. I'm sure you are aware of it that dynamic stabilizers of any joint are usually the muscles around it. So it's biceps, it's triceps, it is brachialis. Alright, so biceps, triceps, and brachialis are the dynamic stabilizer. In static stabilizer, the first static stabilizer is always the capsule. Always, always. Whether it is shoulder or elbow, first static stabilizer is capsule. What is the second one? Second one is lateral or radial collateral ligament complex. Medial or ulnar collateral ligament complex. Alright, so two types of stabilizer, static dynamic, dynamic muscle, biceps, biceps, triceps, brachialis. Starting number one, capsule. Number two, the two sort of ligament. One is on the lateral side, another on the medial side. Lateral radial collateral ligament complex, medial ulnar collateral ligament complex. Don't worry, we will take a look at them. First of all, lateral radial collateral ligament complex. It is the chief stabilizer for varus movements. I hope you know what is varus, right? Varus means, if I say elbow is into varus, so elbow will not go into varus, the part distal to elbow, that is the forearm, the radius and ulna, they will go into varus, right? So when I say varus, that means towards the midline. So if you take forearm towards the midline, what do you think which ligaments will be put to stretch on the elbow? The ligaments which are on the lateral side. So the ligament which is on the lateral side is, of course, the ligament that we are discussing right now, lateral collateral ligament complex or radial collateral ligament complex, right? So it is the chief stabilizer in which particular movement? Varus. Second thing, it is also a posterolateral rotational stabilizer. It's a posterolateral rotational stabilizer. We'll talk about that in some time, don't worry. But now let's take a look. The first ligament, see, radial collateral ligament is a complex, as the name suggests. So this complex further consists of three ligaments. The first one that you are looking at is basically this annular ligament. I'm sure you can appreciate this is the annular ligament. This is the annular ligament. I'm sure you can see that it is surrounding the head of radius. It is clearly visible. Okay, it is surrounding the head of radius. It is the annular or the orbicular ligament. The second ligament that you are looking at right now is the radial collateral ligament. So this ligament, which is merging actually into the annular ligament, is the radial. Can you see that? This is the radial collateral ligament. So this is the radial collateral ligament which is merging. Okay, this is the radial collateral ligament which is technically merging into the annular ligament. So it is, of course, it is coming from the the anterior part of the lateral epicondyle, but it is merging towards the annular ligament. It gets embedded into that. The third ligament that you might observe here is called as lateral ulnar collateral ligament. There is a very simple question again, which is this bone? Ulna. Okay, what is this? The lateral epicondyle. And now I'm sure you can clearly see this ligament. So is it on the lateral side? Yes. Is it connecting to the ulna? Yes. Is it in the collateral shape? Yes. I mean, is it serving what the collaterals normally serve in a joint? Yes. So we call it a lateral ulnar collateral ligament. Normally when we talk to each other, like two orthopedic people, when we talk to each other, we call it LUCL, lateral ulnar collateral ligament, RCL and AL. So the lateral collateral ligament complex is consisting of number one, AL, that is annular ligament, number two, that is the radial collateral ligament, number three, which is the lateral ulnar collateral ligament. So far so good. Now let's take a look at the second static stabilizer, which is the medial or the ulnar collateral ligament complex. Another anatomy in front of you. I'm sure certain things are pretty obvious. It is obvious. All right, so these things are obvious, very obvious. This thing is again very obvious. We have just spoken about the annular ligament. We have just spoken about the radial collateral ligament. We have spoken about all these things. Now let's talk about this medial side. So now we will be talking about the medial ulnar collateral ligament complex. The previous ligament that we saw, the radial or the lateral collateral ligament complex, was having three components. Annular, AL, radial collateral, RCL, and then lateral ulnar collateral, LUCL. Now this medial collateral ligament complex further has got two bundles. I will not say it has got two different set of ligaments. It is one hell of a ligament which has further two bundles. To be very honest, it has three bundles. But the third bundle is not that important, so we don't talk about it. We talk about mainly the two bundle, anterior bundle, posterior bundle. I hope you remember. See, I'm trying to revise as much as I can, even in the video as well, because I want to reinforce these facts into your mind. I hope you remember that when we spoke about the lateral collateral ligament, I told you that that is a primary stabilizer for which injury? For varus movements. So this has to be a stabilizer in which movement? Valgus stabilizer. So lateral collateral ligament complex was for varus stabilization. This is for valgus stabilization. Anterior bundle, posterior bundle. Those two, they contribute towards valgus stabilization, yes or no? Yes. But which of them is more responsible for it? Anterior bundle, and that is something that I have highlighted here. That anterior bundle contributes to the valgus stability more as compared to the posterior bundle. Now let's take a look at the anterior bundle. This anterior bundle is arising from the anteroinferior. If you can see, I'm trying to shade this with this yellow highlighter. This is arising from anteroinferior aspect of the medial epicondyle, and this is going my anterior bundle. So this is that anterior bundle, and it is going and inserting onto which bone? Ulna. Which part? Proximal. Which part? Sublime tubercle. So you have a slight elevation of the ulna here, and that slight elevation of the ulna is what is called as sublime tubercle. So again, this anterior bundle of medial ulnar collateral ligament complex is originating from anteroinferior part of the medial epicondyle and going on to inserting onto the sublime tubercle of the proximal ulna. And then you have the posterior bundle. I'm sure all students can very well appreciate this posterior bundle. I'm sure you can appreciate. And it is important, but it is not that important as compared to the anterior bundle. It provides less stability as compared to the anterior bundle. And now we have the third bundle, which I said that I have not spoken about, is the transverse bundle. This is the transverse part. So all these three bundle, anterior, posterior and transverse, they combine together to make something which is called as medial or ulnar collateral ligament complex. So guys, are you pretty much clear about the stabilizers here? Okay, so stabilizers, static, dynamic mainly muscles. Static first is capsule, second is the lateral collateral ligament complex, in which there are three bundle, annular, radial collateral, lateral ulnar collateral. Then we have the medial or ulnar collateral ligament complex, which has got three bundle, anterior, posterior and transverse. Anterior is the chief one or the primary one for valgus stability. So after this understanding of the anatomy, now let's jump over to the actual topic, the dot of orthopedics, that is the elbow dislocation. First, I'll be giving you an overview. Normally, I'm talking about the normal circumstances, normally we see simple elbow dislocations. In those simple elbow dislocations, of course, we see disruption of MCL, usually with LCL, and along with the disruption of the capsule as well. This is what we observe in the simple dislocations. I'm not talking about dislocation associated with fracture, I'm talking about only dislocations. Second thing that I want all the students to understand is, since it's a one-liner fact, like there's a one-liner fact that almost everyone of you must be aware of it, that most common joint to undergo dislocation is shoulder. So after shoulder, which is the second most common joint to undergo dislocation in you, me, everyone, adults, like we are adults, right? So after shoulder, second most common joint to undergo dislocation is elbow. But there's one more point that I want you to understand, that when we talk about children, categorically children, it is the most common joint to undergo dislocation. So in adults, second most common after shoulder. In children, yes, it is most common. There's one more thing that I want you to understand, is that not only, as I have mentioned in the first point, okay, that usually a simple elbow dislocation will have a disruption of capsule along with MCL, LCL, okay, that's fine. But usually there is a disruption of the muscle origin as well. And I'm sure you are aware of the lateral epicondyle and the medial epicondyle, and you're aware of the common extensor origin and common flexor origin. So let me give this MCQ again to you, that common extensor origin is more extensively injured as compared to the common flexor origin. So somewhere down the line you have understood that out of the flexors and extensors, it is extensors which are usually more commonly injured. Why does this happen? The usual mechanism of injury that we have seen in our clinical practice is something which is very kind of obvious for all upper limb injuries: fuge, fall on outstretched hand. Now, what does this image represent, which is onto the side? This image is representing just one thing, that majority of the injuries, they start from the lateral end and they move circumferentially towards the medial end. So whether we talk about ligaments, whether we talk about muscles or tendons, one thing is for sure, that injury moves from lateral to medial. So there is a particular cycle, that it will start from the lateral end, whether the common extensor origin or the lateral collateral ligament complex, and then we will go towards the medial ligament complex. So it's a complete cycle. And guys, you know what? This cycle is given a name. It is called as Horry's cycle. What are the associated injuries? Now, this will give you some meat. This will give you some MCQs to some of you. Simple elbow dislocation means that there are no fractures. When I say simple dislocation, that means disruption of the ligament, as I've already told you, capsule, as I've already told you, the flexor and extensor muscle origin, as I've already told you. Brachial artery injury is a common thing which has been observed. Definitely a common thing which has been observed. And now let's talk about a very important MCQ, that ulnar nerve is the most commonly injured nerve after an elbow dislocation. I'm sure this will serve a purpose of an MCQ. This is very routinely asked. And you know what, guys, I would like to utilize this moment of this video to tell all my students that please don't get over enthusiastic when you see an MCQ. Because normally what happens, I'll tell you, when you see an MCQ, you get enthusiastic, you get over anxious, and you tend to do mistake. I'll tell you why. A question was asked that most common nerve injury in posterior elbow dislocation. This was a question which was asked. And I don't know why many people, they mark anterior intrusus nerve without giving it a second thought. It is ulnar nerve. But when they say a supracondylar fracture humerus, In a supracondylar fracture humerus, yes, it is anterior interosseous nerve, which is a motor branch of median nerve. So there is a difference between these two topics. Supracondylar fracture humerus is different. Elbow dislocation is different. So here you have ulnar nerve. Here you have anterior interosseous nerve, which is a motor branch of median nerve. So please don't get confused. All right. So now we have come to the conclusion that there are two types of elbow dislocation, simple complex. Simple means disruption of the capsule, the ligament, the tendon origins. Brachial artery injury, most common nerve injury, ulnar nerve. The complex elbow dislocation are usually associated with one or the other fracture, which we will discuss in some time. Let's first finish the simple elbow dislocation. The typical clinical picture, of course, pain, of course, deformity. There is no second point about it. There will be pain, there will be deformity. Now, I'm sure that you all are aware of what is a three bony point relationship. So if you will flex the elbow to 90 degree, the medial condyle, the lateral epicondyle and the olecranon, they should form a triangle, certainly. But that triangle will be kind of reversed. Like if you have a normal triangle like this, medial epicondyle, lateral epicondyle, olecranon. Here you will have a reversal of the triangle because of the posterior elbow dislocation. So they will still form a triangle, but that triangle will be reversed. The relationship will be reversed. And of course, it is, an unsaid dictum to all first year PG resident that a complete peripheral neurological examination of median, radial and ulnar, particularly ulnar nerve, should be done. Okay. Now let's talk about the imaging. I will give you a clear cut idea. The three investigations are usually mentioned: X-ray, CT and MRI. Guys, to be very honest with you, in our clinical practice, we hardly go for an X-ray initially. Of course, we get an X-ray. I'm not saying that we don't get an X-ray, we don't want an X-ray. We get an X-ray. We ask for all three views, AP as well as lateral as well as oblique. But sometimes, you know what, this is more of a clinical intuition, like it's more of a clinical diagnosis. X-ray is done just to rule out any associated fracture. X-ray karane ka jo maksad hai, the purpose is only to rule out an associated capitular fracture or a coronoid fracture or there is an olecranon chunk. So the only purpose is that. Otherwise, it's a clear-cut elbow dislocation. Just go reduce it and get done with your job. Same is the purpose of CT scan. And I would particularly mention here that, you know, what I have done in my clinical practice, I would deliberately ask for a CT scan with a 3D reconstruction, that even if there is a small bony chip, as I mentioned, whether it is a small bony chip of capitulum or coronoid or olecranon, then I should be knowing about it. MRI, to be very honest, I've never asked for any MRI in my entire career till now, unless and until you are looking for some ulnar nerve entrapment in the soft tissue. Apart from that, I don't think so. So an X-ray is good enough. And if you are really, you know, confused that there is some associated fracture, then get a CT done. Now let's talk about the classification. We have already spoken about, just to revise the thing for you, we have already spoken about the anatomy, we have spoken about the osseous anatomy, we have spoken about the soft tissue anatomy. In that we have discussed the static, the dynamic stabilizers, then we went on to elbow dislocation, we have spoken about the simple dislocation, complex I have not even, you know, started. Complex I will give you just a brief idea on that, and simple elbow dislocation we have spoken about the mechanism of injury, how it happens, what are the symptoms, what are the signs, what are the possible MCQs. And now, after investigation, let's jump onto the classification. The image itself is self-explanatory. So, you can clearly see posterior, anterior, lateral, medial, and divergent. So, posterior, I'm sure you can visualize the direction that is going posterior. Anterior, you can visualize the direction. So, aap dekhe, olecranon ka jo direction hai with respect to humerus, us pe sab kuch depend kar raha hai. Olecranon piche ja raha hai, posterior ja raha hai, posterior, olecranon aage aa raha hai, anterior. If it is going towards the radial side, lateral, if it is going towards the ulnar side, you will call it medial. If radius is going towards radial side, ulna is going towards ulnar side, then you will say khul gaya hai, divergent. Okay. So very simple. You have posterior, you have anterior, you have lateral, you have medial, and you have divergent. So these are the five types. A question very routinely asked by a student, which is the most common type, certainly posterior. Certainly. Posterior is the most common type. There is no second point about it. Like the most common nerve injury is ulnar nerve, most common direction is always posterior. This is again something asked very frequently, and please don't get confused. If they ask you most common type of elbow dislocation, don't think of some supracondylar fracture, humerus and mark posterior medial. I see that a lot. It is posterior elbow dislocation. Now let's jump over to the, you know, the complex part of this topic. Till now what you have heard, and which is primarily seen, and which I think is important for UG student and as far as PG aspirants are concerned, is the simple elbow dislocation that we've discussed. Of course, the treatment is still pending, but there are certain complex injury patterns. I will just enumerate the patterns in front of you. Posterior elbow dislocation with a chip fracture of the radial head. Of course, we do see this often. Posterior elbow dislocation plus radial head fracture plus coronoid fracture. You remember coronoid, no? And this is combined together a very, very important MCQ terrible trial given by Hotchkiss. The third pattern of injury that we see is what we call as PMRI. In our language, in orthopedic language, we call it posteromedial or rotational instability, VPMRI, varus posteromedial rotational instability. And I'll tell you, this happens only and only if you have a posterior elbow dislocation with anteromedial facet of the coronoid fracture. So coronoid has got a very important facet, anteromedial facet. If that is fractured along with this, then we land up into VPMRI, that is varus posteromedial rotational instability. Then you have the anterior olecranon fracture dislocation, posterior olecranon fracture dislocation. So these are five complex patterns. First is posterior elbow dislocation with radial fracture. Second is with posterior elbow dislocation with radial fracture. When you add coronoid fracture, it becomes an MCQ Hotchkiss terrible trial. Third is VPMRI. Fourth is anterior olecranon. Fifth is posterior olecranon. Now, after just giving you a brief of the complex patterns, now I will go back to my actual topic, that is elbow dislocation, in which I know most common direction is posterior, and now I will tell all my students how to reduce it. I will not expect any MCQs from it, to be very honest, but still I would like to give you an overview about it. The method is called Parveen's method. Now, what is the first prerequisite? I'm sure you can see the image attached to the theory part as well. So the first job of a first year orthopedic PG is to palpate the medial as well as the lateral epicondyle. And you have to palpate that in relation to the olecranon. Fine. Now you have understood that, okay, you have palpated three important bony prominences, that okay, mera olecranon yahan pe hai, mera medial condyle epicondyle yahan pe hai, lateral epicondyle yahan pe hai. Now you have got a correct idea that what are the three bony points related to each other in the coronal plane. Now the second thing is you will start flexing the elbow. Initially you will flex it by only 30 degree. Now after 30 degree flexion, what a first year PG has to do, he has to apply a traction. The first year PG has to, after flexing the elbow in 30 degree, has to apply traction. While stabilizing the humerus, has to apply traction. I'm sure with this red color, you can see that we are trying to apply traction. So you have to understand, the elbow has gone posteriorly, so traction has to be applied. All right. Now, there are certain cases in which it becomes a little difficult. It becomes a little difficult to put that olecranon back into its place. So that is why our textbook says that direct pressure over the olecranon may help to guide it over the distal humerus and thereby into the joint. And my students, you can clearly see what I'm doing here. So, elbow flexion, 30 degree. Then application of distal traction. After palpating the three bony point, getting a hang and idea of it, keep applying traction. Then with one hand, try to push the olecranon back into its place so that it glides over the distal humerus directly into the joint. And now, what is very important is that if you will supinate the forearm, that will be helpful in achieving the reduction early. So to summarize, elbow flexion by 30 degree. Analyze the three bony points by palpating them and getting a hang of them. Then apply gentle traction to the distal part, and then while stabilizing the humerus, put the point, put your hand or your thumb or your, you know, put the effort, your efforts with your two thumbs or maybe thumb and finger onto the olecranon and try to glide it into the distal part of the humerus and thereby into the elbow joint. You will feel that sudden thud into it and then supinate and your reduction is done. But that doesn't mean your job is over. No. That doesn't mean your job is over. After reduction, the elbow has to be taken into a complete arc of flexion, extension, in pronation, neutral, and supination to see whether there is residual instability or not. So you will have to complete the arc. You will have to first take the upper limb into pronation, then do flexion extension, then supination, do flexion extension, in neutral position, flexion and extension to analyze the residual instability. Now, when a first year PG gets to know that, he has to make a call to the senior resident. If elbow redislocates when flexed to less than 30 degree, then he has to give a call that, sir, I got a so-and-so patient, I've reduced so-and-so, but after reduction, while I was checking the arc of motion in pronation, supination, and the neutral position, I could see that elbow is redislocating again, even in less than 30 degree of flexion. If elbow dislocates in, say, 70, 80, 90, okay, that's obvious. It will have a tendency to go into dislocation because the associated ligaments are ruptured, the capsule is ruptured. But even if in less than 30 degree of flexion, elbow is redislocating again, that means just reduce that elbow temporarily, fix it for OT, inform the seniors. And to be very honest, don't worry about varus valgus instability because, see, that is not that important. Why? Because majority of the people will have that because the ligaments are ruptured and they will take time to heal. So, after a successful close reduction, the check is very important that if there is a redislocation of elbow in less than 30 degree of flexion, then that is a call for surgery, varus valgus instability. We can accept that. We can allow the, you know, healing part to happen. And then, of course, elbow is to be immobilized in a light plaster splint. So this is depending upon the maximum stability that you can achieve, and the elbow should be in 90 degree flexion. So that depends upon, I mean, this is something which is not a very hard and fast rule. It depends upon case to case, person to person, how he takes it after reduction. I'm trying to discuss this not only for UG and PG aspirants, but trying to incline this topic towards first year residents as well. So I would request them to listen again. Now, x-rays are performed post-reduction to ensure that whether you have done a congruous reduction or not, and even to look for any presence of fracture which you might have missed on the pre-reduction x-ray. Because it's a process of constant learning and evolution. I'm sure everyone knows that. So it has happened with me, at least, certainly I have not counted it, but many times that while reducing or before reduction, we got an x-ray, we could not see anything. After reduction and checking the entire arc of motion, then we applied a splint and then we got a check x-ray done to ensure we have reduced perfectly or not. And I could see that there is a slight chip of coronoid, and then we got a CT scan with a 3D reconstruction next day, and we took a call for surgery. Since it was not a simple elbow dislocation, it was a complex pattern. In complex pattern, as I've already told you, that we need to operate. Now, there is something again, as I told you that I started this topic for UG and PG aspirants, but the later half of the topic I took it for the first year residents. This is something which is now emphasized upon by seniors, by journals, by standard textbooks, that immobilization more than 3 weeks should not be done. I hope many of you know that whenever we apply a cast for a fracture, we usually tend to keep it for 6 weeks. Okay, in 3 weeks we check for callus formation, and then 6 weeks we remove the cast and stuff like that. Particularly elbow dislocation, immobilization beyond 6 weeks should be avoided because there is an increased incidence of stiffness and a very, 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 very poor functional outcome. So this is a point to be emphasized upon, that you might be good at your reduction, but if you are a little afraid of the fact that you will remove the cast in 3 to 3.5 weeks and that might lead to re-dislocation, don't worry. You have to remove the cast because there are two aspects of it. One is the risk of re-dislocation, that is not that much, as you have the risk of stiffness of elbow and a poor functional recovery of the elbow if you prolong the immobilization period. Elbow is anyways a very tricky joint, as it is, you know, mentioned in our orthopedic lectures as well, we used to get trained by our seniors that it is a tricky joint. So a good orthopedic surgeon is that who knows when to immobilize an elbow, and a great orthopedic surgeon is that who knows when to mobilize it again. So 3 weeks is the golden period. So in this video, I have tried my level best to integrate the undergraduates, the PG aspirants, and even the first, second year PG residents as well. So thank you so much. I hope you like the video. My best wishes to all of you guys. And this is Dr. Tushar Mehta signing off. I will be presenting with and coming up with one more video very soon. Thank you so much.